Here we go. So welcome everybody to today's implementation of the IGS seminar series. It's my pleasure to introduce former colleague and longtime friend, Dr. Granger Sutton. He got his BS in electrical engineering in College Park, master's in computer engineering at Stanford, and then his PhD in computer science back in College Park. He's actually a member of the College Park's Alumni Hall of Fame for all of the achievements he's completed over the years. So once he got his PhD, Granger went straight to Tiger and worked there from its inception together with Claire Fraser and Craig Venter and others. And as you know, that was really pioneering work in the field of whole genome shotgun sequencing. And Granger has been there directing informatics. Then he became a professor, an adjunct professor of informatics later at the J. Craig Venter Institute. But the pioneering work that Granger was so important for was his work on generating the first assembler to put whole genome shotgun sequencing data into a genome. You know, that was a new field at the time. And thanks to Granger and his assembler, this became a real field and something that nobody can think to live without these days. And that resulted, of course, in the first genome of a free living organism, Haemophilus influenzae. And since after that, you know, Granger was also a founding member of the assembly team for the Celera genomics endeavor. And of course, most of you know that resulted first in the whole Drosophila genome assembly, but then a human genome assembly, mouse, and then many more since then. And Celera assembler is still a state-of-the-art assembler that people are using today. So currently, Granger is a bioinformatics consultant for Intelligence Advanced Research Projects Activity, which is a government agency under the Director of National Intelligence. That sounds really scary. And in that context, he's been applying his latest development on the Pan-genome pipeline and computation to detect engineered organisms. So that's really exciting. And he's going to tell us a lot about that Pan-genome business and how it should be handled and how to go about it in the talk that's coming. On a personal note, I've been delighted to see Granger a bunch of times on the disc golf courses recently, and that was from a distance, and that was very nice. And it's also a great timing for your talk, Granger, today, because it's going to be Claire and my birthday this weekend. So it's a great birthday gift that you're giving us here. For the attendants, I asked Granger, he'd be happy to answer some questions while he speaks, but still post them in the chat or raise your hand. I will man that and I might interrupt him if I think we should answer a question before he goes on too far onto other topics. Otherwise, we'll tackle all of those questions at the end. So please post. And with that, Granger, please go ahead. I look forward to your presentation.
Well, thank you, Hervé, for that kind introduction. So what I want to talk about is some recent new tool development that I've been involved in for pan-genome analysis. As Hervé said, this has been funded by IARPA, which I didn't know about until I got the funding. It's the intelligence agency's equivalent of DARPA. What they were interested in was being able to recognize engineering of organisms. And part of the approach to doing that was to generate a pangenome and compare a novel genome to that pangenome to see what looked out of place. But that's not the primary focus of my talk today. Obviously, the tools that were developed for that have a multitude of uses for pangenome analysis, and that's more about what I'm going to talk about. So I'll start my talk with a little introduction for those who need it to brush up on what a pangenome is. And then I'll talk mostly about two recent papers, one about core regions and one about Waltakoic acid biosynthesis that we stumbled upon based on our core region analysis of pangenomes. And at the end, if we have time, I'll talk about a new direction that we've gone for scaling up our pan-genome approach that uses k-mers instead of the annotated features that we traditionally used for our pan-genome analysis. So a pan-genome is a mapping of a set of genomes onto each other. And for a given set of genomic features or genes, we determine a one-to-one equivalency between those features for each genome. And this generates a cluster. Sometimes we call that an orthologous gene cluster. But it can be features other than genes, such as certain RNA features, as long as they're long enough to be able to be distinct within the genome by searching for homology. Core clusters contain features in all or almost all genomes. Dispensable clusters are in two or more genomes. Unique clusters are in only one genome. And my work focuses primarily on species, subspecies, genome groupings. Sometimes the concept of a pan-genome is extended further, such as across all bacteria, but that's not what I'm going to be talking about. So the first thing I want to talk about is something that sometimes get missed, and that's quality control. So NCBI has gotten better over the years, but it does not sufficiently police submissions for what is a species. So if you pull down genomes, even from RefSeq, saying I want this species, you'll often get things that aren't that species. So we upfront do an average nucleotide identity analysis, and we use the MASH tool, which is a fast comparator that generates reasonably accurate estimates of what the average nucleotide identity between any two genomes is. So what we found based on the literature and our own work is that species generally cluster at between 95 and 97% ANI, and subspecies cluster at 97 to 98% ANI, and that you can use that as a good rule of thumb for what you want to include in your pan-genome analysis. We've also found that redundant genomes can bias your pan-genome results. So if there's been a lot of pandemic, for instance, sequencing of basically the same strain over and over again, if you include all those strains, then you're really just doing a pan-genome of that strain, not of the species. So we do a step that removes highly redundant genomes from our analysis. This is a figure from a few years ago where I was trying to pull a pan-genome for Bacillus subtilis. And so I pulled all of Bacillus because it wasn't clear what was in the Bacillus genus. And then a smaller clade that was obviously closer to Bacillus subtilis included just one or two other species. But what I show here is that the Bacillus subtilis subspecies subtilis clade, which is in blue, has most of the genomes, and it's fairly distant from the other subspecies of B. subtilis. The closest one shown in green is down around, 94 to 95% ANI. And the other ones shown in red and purple are even further away. So when I was deciding to do a B. subtilis pan-genome, I decided it made more sense to do a pan-genome of the B. subtilis subspecies subtilis clade rather than trying to be more broad. And this is the kind of thing you should do when you're making your determination for what you want to include in your pan-genome. We have one tool that helps with this analysis, and it's been published on. I give a list of papers at the end of the talk, and I've provided the slides to Rehan, and you can get them. But the GGRAS tool takes an all versus all ANI matrix generated by MASH, for instance, and then it does some clustering and some analysis of that clustering to determine where you're seeing your boundaries. So under the two here is an analysis of all of the pairwise ANI values, and you can decide that maybe the subspecies cutoff should be here between, you know, the green peak and the orange peak. And sometimes you'll see redundant genomes will be, you know, up at 100% here, and you can say, you know, I want to set my threshold for redundant genomes at 99.99 or something like that. So I just want to go over a little bit more of the of how I've approached pangenome analysis, and this should be familiar to all of you. Homology is not the same as orthology or orthology paralogs. It's a larger idea. So a protein's a similar sequence or homologous. Proteins inherited directly from the same most recent common ancestor are orthologs, and proteins derived from a duplication event are paralogs. A lot of times, the hard part of doing pangenome analysis is separating the diverged paralogs into appropriate orthologous clusters. And I'll show you how we've approached that with PanOct and later with the pangenome graph. But we go a little bit further than that and try and say equivalent genes, which is even more strict than just orthology, because in orthology, if you've had a recent duplication in one genome but not in the other, both of those genes are set of those duplicated genes are said to be orthologs of the one that hasn't been duplicated in the other genome. But we want all of our clusters to contain at most one sequence from any genome in order to do a very strict mapping. So we come up with this idea of strict one-to-one assignment or operationally equivalent genes that's stricter than orthologs. So for us, the way we separate paralogs and these orthologs that don't have a one-to-one equivalency is based on what we call gene neighborhood information. And that's basically the clear-cut orthologs that are adjacent to the gene in question. So most of the genes and genomes are not duplicated, and it's easy via homology searching to determine that they're the appropriate orthologs. So then you can use that information to help determine the ones that aren't obvious. And I've showed that in this figure, where the top line is one genome and the bottom line is a second genome. And P and P prime are paralogs in the first genome, and C prime and C are paralogs in the second genome. And the genes connected by dots, like NO, QR, you know, N is obviously orthologous to F, et cetera. So these genes in the neighborhood of the hard to determine genes give you a foundation for how to assign them. So the concept is that P and C prime might be slightly more homologous, have a higher ANI, maybe they're even 100% identical, whereas P and C might have a single base pair change and so not be quite as identical. But we think that the gene neighborhood information should override that, and that P and C prime have the one-to-one equivalency in our mind versus P and C. So that's our basic assumption for how these equivalencies should be generated. And that's the way PanOct works, and that's the way the current PGG pipeline works. So what's the difference between a pangenome graph and just a pangenome? So pangenome takes a sort of bag of genes approach. It says this genome contains this set of genes, and for this pangenome, it generates clusters that says these genes are in this cluster, but it doesn't take into account the layout of the genes within the genome. A pangenome graph is interested in capturing not just the pangenome, the clusters, but also in capturing how those clusters are laid out in all of the genomes. And this includes both the order and orientation of the genome. So for the pangenome graph, or I'll just say PGG going forward, the nodes of the PGG are the pangenome clusters. The edges of the PGG are instantiated when two nodes are adjacent in one or more genomes. And the weight of the edge is basically, you know, how many genomes those genes are adjacent in. Strictly speaking, the edges are bidirected because the nodes have directionality. So there's the 5' and 3' end of a gene, and it's, you know, one end or the other that's adjacent to one end or the other of another gene. So strictly speaking, the graph is actually a bidirected graph. So if every genome had the same set of genes and they were all in the same order and orientation, the graph would be what's called a linear graph, where there's no branching. Each node would have a single outgoing edge to the next node, and it would just be a straight line with beads on it. Why do you see branching in a PGG? You see it because of differences in feature content. As we all know, for bacterial genomes, for instance, different strains have different sets of genes. A second reason is when you have rearrangement of genomic regions. So if you see an inversion of a region of the genome, then you're going to get branching between the different genomes. You can see this also with element insertions such as transposons. And for our ARPA funding partners, you will see it for synthetic engineering. Why do we see variation within a cluster or node or on the edge of the PGG? So when we're looking at variability, and I'll get to that later in the talk, reasons are just natural evolutionary drift, recombination, or again, synthetic engineering. This is a toy example to hopefully give you more of an idea of what the pangenome graph looks like. This is just four genomes, and it's just a little teeny portion of what the graph would be for just six genes. Gene one and gene five would be core genes, and in between those two genes, you're seeing variability in the other four genomes. So what the top edge shows is that for one genome, there's nothing in between gene one and gene five. For two genomes, there's a three gene insertion, genes two, three, and four, and they're all oriented on the forward strain. And for the fourth genome, there's a different gene, a single gene, gene six, that's in the reverse orientation on the opposite strand inserted between genes one and five. So that's what the pangenome graph captures, except it's capturing it for, you know, somewhere between five and several hundred thousand genes and, you know, the equivalent number of edges, which makes it a lot harder to draw and is one of the challenges that we have in visualization. Something we think about is how to display that kind of information about the graph in a visually usable way. And one concept is what's the consensus for that graph? And a consensus for us is basically just a path through the graph. So one idea is sort of a plurality protein layout where you just take what's most frequently seen and you include all the non-core genes, and wherever there's non-core genes, you just pick whatever's present in most of the genomes. And a different kind of consensus that we like to think about is just where the core genes are And we leave the non-core genes out in terms of the consensus, but we keep track of where they would be inserted into that backbone. And the way this manifests in terms of visualization, and the way we did it for our tool Panacea, is that you present the core gene backbone and, you know, one of these familiar circular figures with the core genes laid out, but you also indicate where all the insertions are. You indicate where the more penetrant insertions are, that is the insertions that are present for more of the genomes, and ones that are larger, for instance. You allow the user to select on different criteria which of those variable regions of the genome, sometimes called flexible genomic islands, they're interested in. And for each flexible genomic island, you let them drill down and you show the different variations for different genomes of what's there. You provide, you know, an ability to generate trees based on gene content or on gene identity. You show multiple sequence alignments. You show a gene cluster page with annotation you have for that particular gene within that flexible genomic island. And one thing that this led us to is interesting things that you see. So for we were doing analysis of Enterobacter hermachii, and there's five different subspecies of hermachii. And what we saw was that between core genes, so these genes on the end are core genes, in some subspecies, you would see one metabolic synthesis operon that was homologous to the E. coli AGA operon. And in other subspecies, you would see a different metabolic operon equivalent to the E. coli GAD operon. And so these were, you know, distinguishing features between subspecies that you know, showed up via this pan-genome analysis. So my more recent work has been about generating a more consistent analysis of pan-genome. So PANOCT, which is what I was largely describing above, takes a set of annotations, and we generally used RefSeq annotations because that way they would be reasonably consistent. But even RefSeq annotations aren't totally consistent. And in order to do very accurate pan-genome analysis, you need your features that you're capturing to be consistent across all genomes. And the way we decided to attack this was to generate an initial pan-genome graph, as I've demonstrated how you should do. But then instead of ending there, we decided to take the pan-genome graph and use it to annotate the genomes that made up the pan-genome graph, to re-annotate them using the pan-genome graph. And the way we did this was, we take the medoid sequence for each cluster, so the gene sequence that most accurately describes the cluster, and then we search all those medoids against the genome that we're re-annotating. In most cases, like I said, there's only one obvious match, and it's easy to annotate those genes. Some, you know, small set of cases, there's paralogs that need to be differentiated. And again, we use gene context, but now the gene context we're using is the pan-genome graph, not another genome that we're comparing to. And the pan-genome graph, you know, is an encapsulation of all the other genomes, so it gives you a more accurate gene neighborhood that way. So we use this combination of homology and gene neighborhood to assign the accurate gene for that genome. And then we do and Needleman Wunsch alignment to accurately get the appropriate boundaries for the gene. So in some cases, the annotation might have been entirely missing a gene for that genome. It might have been misannotating it as another gene, or it might have had the boundaries wrong for the gene. And by doing this re-annotation, we're making that annotation consistent. And the last bullet point here includes the fact that for proteins, when a degraded protein exists, there might not have been an accurate annotation of that degraded protein, or it might have been annotated as a pseudogene, and the boundaries might not have been well defined. Some people would say you shouldn't include that in a pangenome, but my assertion is that you want to capture that evolutionary history, even if it is degraded. So this is just a simple flow chart of what I'm talking about for how we do our pangenome analysis now. We download complete genomes from RefSeq. Occasionally, when you can't get them from RefSeq, we'll do something else. But the nice thing about RefSeq is they already do a certain amount of quality control, and they provide a good initial set of annotations. We compute the genome ANI using MASH, and we get rid of outliers that aren't really in the group that we want. And it can also help you decide how you're going to set your boundary, whether you want to do a subspecies or a species. We remove the redundant genomes using GGRASP. We generate our initial PGG using PANOCT. And then we do the process that I just talked to you through about re-annotating genomes using the PGG. So you do it the first time, in just the way I talked about. And then you look and you say, did the PGG change? And you just compare the nodes and the edges, and the answer is yes or no. If it did change, then you iterate and do it again. And when it stops changing, you stop. Now, for most large pangenomes, it never completely stops changing. You'll see it usually oscillate between two or three states where the number of nodes or edges is changing by one. So there is, you know, a stopping criteria where it's not completely stopped changing. For small sets of genomes, you'll actually see it completely stop changing. So this brings me to the part of my talk about the paper that we wrote about core regions for B. subtilis and E. coli. So we, you know, these are two well-studied organisms, and we thought our new method should be published and brought to people's attention. We wanted to use an example. So that we could demonstrate to people what the usefulness was. And so we chose two organisms that we were working with anyway, and that have obviously been studied a lot. One was B. subtilis, one was E. coli. So I'm just showing how the quality control works. First, we did the download from RefSeq, and I show the number of genomes that we got. And I should say that for E. coli, we included the Shigella genome since they're really the same species. Then we showed the ANI classification step. You can see that we removed 11 of the B. subtilis genomes because, and this is actually B. subtilis subspecies subtilis, because 11 of them weren't. We only had to remove one of the E. coli genomes. Then we did the redundancy filtering. And you know, for B. subtilis, for instance, the type strain has been completely sequenced like 8 times. And there were some other redundancies, as you can see, for E. coli, not quite so much. And then the final genome set just had to do with the fact that we added in a couple of the reference strains that essential genes had been determined for. And for B. subtilis, we took out a genome which had been synthetically engineered to delete some of the genes. Okay, so I want to show you what PGG refinement buys you. And in the very first line, the size one OGCs, OGC is just the abbreviation for orthologous gene cluster. What you can see is for B. subtilis, the initial, sorry, I've lost my pointer. There we go. For B. subtilis, the initial set of genes that were unique, only present in one genome, was 1,000 more than after we did the refinement. And what this is genes that were misannotated on a single genome and were overlapping with genes that were annotated more frequently on other genomes. And so the misannotated gene is done away with in because the better annotated gene is used in its place. And you can see the effect for E. coli is much, much larger. And that's, I believe, primarily because there's 10 times as many genomes for E. coli. But it might be that the misannotation rate is higher too. So in the second line, we see shared OGCs. So these are ones that are present in more than a single genome. And you would expect the size of these to go up because if something was a singleton and it was really true and you then instantiate it in the other genomes, this would go up. And that's what you see for B. subtilis, a small increase. But for E. coli, you actually see that drop. And I think that's because with 10 times as many genomes, now you're seeing probably misannotation that's in two or more genomes, but still not in most. On the third line, we have the number of genes in shared OGCs. So this is, you know, for each gene cluster, how many genomes is it in? And you see an increase in size because there's some missed annotations that are present in some genomes initially, but when you do the consistent annotation, you find they're actually present in more genomes than was initially thought, and you see a big jump in how many genes are in these shared OGCs. So in an example for E. coli, the number of shared OGCs is decreasing dramatically from 68,000 to 48,000, but the number of genes in those shared OGCs is going up dramatically. So for comparison to other papers, we set our threshold for what we called core at three different thresholds, 95% of genomes to be considered core, 99% or 100% or all genomes to be determined core. And what you see about the PGG refinement is that without doing consistent annotation, you're going to see your definition of core be degraded until you do the consistent annotation, at which point you recover a lot of genes that the annotation was missed. And this was particularly seen in the E. coli with a core definition of 100%, you're basically doubling the number of core genes from 713 to 1501. So what is a core region? It's just an extension of the idea of a core gene or a core gene cluster. So once you've determined the core genes, you want to see whether they're in the same region of the genome. And so you look at the core edge between the core genes, and the edge between the core genes, and if the edge is core as well, then you connect those two genes and you can actually generate coordinates for each genome in the pan-genome saying these are the regions that are core between those genomes. And one of the reasons this is important is that this means that for that PGG, you're not seeing any insertions in those regions, that the genome doesn't like to tolerate insertions or deletions in those regions. And we think this is important information for people who are working on synthetic engineering. So this is a figure that's in the paper about core regions, essential genes, and deletions. And what it shows is that major essential genes, you don't see any deletions. And where there aren't a lot of essential genes, you see a lot of deletions. And why is this important to us? Well, so we wanted to evaluate our method for determining a PGG and for determining core genes and core regions. And for us, the way to do that was to compare against essential genes. And the assumption is that essential genes will occur in all strains of a species and hence be core genes. And I think that's a good assumption. But once we started getting into the details, there are potentially some exceptions. So the most frequent exception we found was the genes that form toxin-antitoxin pairs or restriction enzyme methylation partners have to either both be present or both be absent in a strain. And these have been called by others protective essential genes. So they're not essential in terms of actually being necessary for the strain to survive unless the other one, unless the toxin's there. If the toxin's there, you have to have the antitoxin. And of course, you know, it's possible that you could have non-orthologous replacement that would allow a strain to live with by some other method than having the essential gene, although we don't see any obvious cases of that. And the final case is that it could just fall below our 90% identity homology threshold for what we're willing to put into an orthologous gene cluster. And we did see more of that. So when we dove into genes in Bacillus subtilis, which weren't, which were essential, but were not core, this is one small example of a set of genes and the pan-genome graph between those two core genes. So the numbers inside the little polygons are just the cluster identifier. In the parentheses, it's the number of genomes. So in this pan-genome, there are 108 Bacillus subtilis subspecies subtilis. So 3993 and 3996 are core, 100% core clusters. 3994 is an essential gene, but it was only present in 97 genomes. Gene clusters 8718 and 6436 actually have homology to 3994. At the protein level, they're down around 80% identity, and actually the same at the nucleotide level. Our pangenome pipeline and other people's pangenome pipelines did not combine these clusters. Now, you can tune our pipeline to have these collapsed into one. But part of the reason we set the 90% threshold is that when you're doing the reannotation of the genome using the medoid sequences for the clusters, to get good alignment, you need a certain percent identity to do boundary refinement. And we decided that 90% was a reasonable threshold to set. Anyway, so this is what we found in the graph for a couple of the essential genes that you were seeing very diverged versions of the gene, but the ortholog was basically there for the essential gene. It just was showing up as very diverged. And in some cases you'd see extra auxiliary genes coming in as well. So in working on our paper, we looked at comparing strains of synthetically engineered B. subtilis that had been done historically to investigate the genome. And what we found was that initially the Delta 6 was the first variant, and then these others are basically descendants of Delta 6. But for all of these, what they had in common, the initial deletions that they tried were the low-hanging fruit, and these are mostly, in the second column, non-core genes. So they're removing phage and insertion sequences and things like that that are fairly easy to decide can go. But they are getting rid of, you know, a small number of core genes as well. And then for, you know, further down the chain, as they start deleting more sequences, they still got rid of a fair amount of the easy stuff, but now they're really deleting the core genes. So even though we assert that essential genes should be core, we do not assert that core genes should be essential. Obviously, they define something about the species that, you know, is particular to its lifestyle, that are usually beneficial, but you don't have to have them to survive. And this progression continues where they're getting rid of, you know, fewer and fewer non-core genes, and most of what they're deleting now are core genes, and they have to understand the biology to make those decisions. But we do assert that we've got some suggestions for some more deletions they could make if they just based on the pan-genome analysis. So we looked at the largest number of non-core genes in a region that hadn't been deleted yet. So for the most deleted genome from the previous table, this is the set of genes that had more than seven or more non-core genes in a region together. And then what we looked at was the pan-genome graph in those regions to see whether there was the possibility that the reason they were non-core was that there were, homologous proteins in a similar way to the figure I showed you. And that's captured in the last column, where if there aren't any alternate genes, these are just non-core genes that we think are dispensable and could be deleted. So you can see we identify three regions of 7, 10, and 13 that could still undergo further deletion. But I've highlighted in red one region of 28 genes where there is a lot of branching, and which is the subject of our next paper on valtecoic acids. So what are valtecoic acids? They're genes that are involved in production of anionic glycopolymers required for consistent cell shape and division. Not being a biologist, I'll mostly leave it at that. What we saw was when we were comparing the core genes to the essential genes, there was this large cassette. And by cassette, I mean that they were all in the same region of the genome that were involved in this WTA synthesis. And the branching in the PGG showed that it would branch and then it would come together into a core gene. And that you were basically seeing alternate versions of the pathway. One alternate version of the pathway was already known. There's a variation in these glycopolymers, one that uses ribitol versus glycerol. And initially, it was thought that these two versions were distinguished by being in different subspecies of B. subtilis. One in speciesini and one in subtilis. Later work, it was found that in fact it was not distinguishing between the two subspecies. So what did we do? We isolated the 144 orthologous gene clusters that were involved in these cassettes. And like I said, they were collinear in the genomes. So it was easy to say basically all gene clusters between this core gene and that core gene were involved in these cassettes. And we did a Jacquard clustering and a Jacquard distance matrix based on those genes. So for those who don't know, the Jacquard distance is just one minus the intersection of a set over the union, the intersection of two sets over the union of two sets. So if you have exactly the same genes, then the distance is zero. And if all the genes are different, then you have a distance of one. And this tree shows the result of using that Jacquard distance matrix. And we distinguished seven clades based on this tree. Two of them were the well-known ribitol and glycerol clades, and the other four were novel. Some of them had genes that more closely aligned with either the well-known ribitol or glycerol, but some of them really weren't easily classifiable. What got more interesting is we did a ANI-based tree, average nucleotide identity tree, for the 108 strains. This is for all genes, so whole genome ANI for those 108 strains. And when we keep the colors the same for the clades that the previous tree had determined for the WTA genes, you can see that the ANI tree does not neatly encapsulate the same lineages. So these lineages are not being, so if we assume that ANI captures evolution, which is generally believed to be true, you can see that these gene cassettes are not being passed down cleanly from ancestor to descendant. There isn't some clear top level place where the cassette diverged and then it was maintained through the descendants. Instead, you see some swapping going on. In particular, for instance, here, and over here. So what's going on here? We think homologous recombination is going on, and there's pressure for this to happen. So WTA genes are involved in phage defense, phage avoidance, and they're implicated in evasion of host immunity response. And they've also been indicated as potential antibacterial targets. But we think the pressure is coming from trying to evade phage and from trying to evade host immune response. And, you know, a standard mechanism for organisms to use is homologous recombination. And we think this WTA gene cassette is clearly a region that uses that mechanism. One thing nice about the PGG is it allows you to extract out these regions, and then you can draw pretty pictures of the different clades and how they're represented by different gene content. And that's what this figure demonstrates. So next, I want to talk about novelty detection. And I think, I guess there's two things that I really want people to get out of this talk. One is
looks like Granger froze.
Can you use these tools to do ventures?
You just froze a little bit.
So. I can hear you fine.
Okay, but you froze for like 15 seconds. So if you can start over on this, and
okay,
maybe we'll have to wrap up in about 5 minutes.
Okay. So two things I want to get out of this is that you can find interesting things about your species, like the WTA gene cassettes, based on pan-genome graph analysis. And the second thing is that you can compare a new genome against the PGG and find novel features to that genome. So we have a pipeline that will find all novel insertions and all novel deletions compared to the pan genome. So you can say this new genome is missing these genes that are present in every other genome, or it has this new inserted 10,000 base pairs that we've never seen before. In addition, it generates multiple sequence alignments for all the nodes and edges, and it allows you to look for novelty in comparison to those multiple sequence alignments based on two different distance measures, which you can look at this. And the part that I said I put at the end is the more computer science-y part. And for scaling the PGG methods, what I just talked about doesn't really work for eukaryotic genomes because they're too large and they're too sparse and they have too many repeats. So we generated a k-mer-based approach. And basically you're looking for unique k-mers across all the genomes, ones that only occur once. This makes it easier to search for them and it improves the efficiency of search. It also improves the density of features. So for new eukaryotic genomes, if I was going to use exons, I'd be getting 3% of the genome. By using unique k-mers, I can usually get better than 90% of the genome. So there's slides in here that talk a lot about different sorting mechanisms and why they're efficient. And for any computer scientists that you know, you're happy to talk to them about bucket sorts and things like that, but I'm not going to talk to you about them unless somebody asks a question. So after we did this k-mer based method, just to make sure it was really working, we constructed a synthetic B. subtilis genome with known insertions, deletions, tandem duplications, and gene mutations. And we showed that our old traditional method of generating a PGG identified all these novel elements. And then we constructed the k-mer-based anchors method, and we showed that it also was able to identify the mechanisms. So then what was important was to show that this scaled. And so we captured the time for each of these different PGGs that we constructed. And what you can see is, that the wall time and the CPU time. So the reason why the wall time is so much higher is because these processes are I/O bound, which means they're not using CPU, they're just using I/O. But both the wall time and the CPU scale linearly. And what's even nicer is that the memory, once it hits its maximum set that it's designed to hit, it stays constant. These are the papers that capture the work that I've talked about. I just wanted to put them here for your reference, and I also wanted to put them here to remind me to thank my co-authors for their help with all of this work. And I wanted to acknowledge my IARPA funding for the Felix project. And that's it, and I'm ready for questions.